Good evening and welcome to Gravitas. I'm Palki Sharma Upadhyay. Let's get started.
Gravitas, co-presented by Škoda Superb, best in next class. Co-powered by Star Health Insurance, the health insurance specialist.
Do you believe that the Wuhan virus is indeed a bioweapon, that it was created in a laboratory?
It is man-made or not. It's a Wuhan virus.
What are your expectations from it? Do you believe it will be a fair probe given the fact that this global agency has been accused of being influenced?
I think the Chinese government and also WHO have to explain what's going on.
How do you see China's military provocations on the border with India?
We, the Japan, also have lots of fear from the Chinese military activities. I can understand Indians' feelings towards those matters. We want strong India, and we want India. India is the Asian's gravity point.
And what are your expectations from the Biden administration?
China and also Taiwan border. This border is going to become another red line. Which White House should think about.
After the Second World War, in 1949, India donated an elephant to a zoo in Tokyo, a token of friendship to the Japanese people who still had not recovered from the war. In 1952, Japan and India signed a peace treaty, one of the first signed by Japan after the war. Almost 70 years later, Japan and India are close strategic partners. Binding them is not just history and democratic values, but also a common adversary. China's territorial aggression has manifested itself in Ladakh in India and in the Senkaku Islands in the East China Sea. Both countries are members of the Quad, the quadrilateral alliance that aims to counter China. What does the future hold for these two? How do they jointly counter the dragon? We put these questions to Japan's Deputy Defense Minister, Yasuhide Nakayama, in an exclusive interview today. We talked about the pandemic, China's role in it, the probe by the World Health Organization, the place of India in Asia's power matrix, and expectations from the Biden administration. Tonight on Gravitas, we bring you that exclusive interview. Also on the show, the big headline that the world is watching. The Brexit deal is finally done after years of back and forth. They say it is a fair deal. It's time to turn the page. Baloch activists found dead in Canada. Local police say there is no foul play. But protests in Balochistan and Canada, the family now urging the Trudeau government to investigate further. Outrage over US President Donald Trump's pardons. 41 convicts pardoned in 48 hours, including his son-in-law Jared Kushner's father and Trump's own allies. Daniel Pearl's killer is set to walk free. A court in Sindh in Pakistan has announced his release. Will the Pakistan government appeal the decision? We'll track this for you. But we begin, as always, with Gravitas Global Headlines.
Israel has detected four cases of the new variant of the coronavirus that has emerged in the UK. Three of the cases were returnees from England and are isolating at a hotel designated as a coronavirus quarantine facility. The fourth case is under investigation. Amid the border crisis after France imposed a partial blockade over the new coronavirus strain in the UK, a team of French firefighters arrived at Dover Port with 10,000 coronavirus tests for lorry drivers to let those who test negative cross the channel by Christmas. Russian lawmakers have passed bills which could grant authorities the power to block access to YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook. The country could restrict access to US social media giants if they discriminate against content from Russian state media. Lawmakers argued the social media websites had failed to remove hundreds of pages containing banned content, as required by Russian law. Nigerian officials have said the kidnapping of 344 schoolboys earlier this month was not sparked by extremism and that it was caused by intercommunal feuding over cattle theft, grazing rights, and water access. In the latest blow for Jack Ma's e-commerce empire, China has launched an investigation into the Alibaba Group for suspected monopolistic behavior and will summon the Ant Group for a meeting in the coming days. The moves follow China's dramatic suspension last month of Ant's planned $37 billion initial public offering. A senior Taliban commander has put down his arms and returned to the mainstream. Haji Lala was captured by Pakistani security agencies. When he was released, he decided to give up his old ways and cut a deal with the Afghan police, who arranged for him to return home to Kandahar. Millions of COVID-19 vaccines are sitting unused in American hospitals. In the last 2 weeks, only 1 million vaccine jabs have been used, and over 9.5 million doses are yet to be administered. Drone footage showed Bethlehem wearing a deserted look and waking up to a less festive Christmas amid the pandemic. Hotels that were adding new wings in 2019 are shuttered. The town leaders say they will go ahead with the celebrations, given that the world's eyes are upon them. French champions Paris Saint-Germain have sacked their manager, Thomas Tuchel, just hours after he oversaw a 4-0 win over Strasbourg in Ligue 1. Last year's Champions League finalists have already lost 6 games across competitions this season, but the reason for Tuchel's departure is reported to be a falling out with club director Leonardo. PSG have already contacted former Tottenham manager Mauricio Pochettino to take over after a 2-week Christmas break. The Swiss Federal Tribunal has upheld the appeal of Chinese swimmer Sun Yang and ordered a fresh hearing process at the Court of Arbitration for Sport. An 11-time world champion and 3-time Olympic gold medalist, Sun was banned for 8 years in February after refusing to cooperate with dope testers in 2018. But Sun's lawyers presented evidence that the chairman of the CAS panel had made racist comments about China and alleged that he was therefore not completely neutral, which was accepted.
It started in the month of May. The Chinese military provoked India in Ladakh, right in the middle of this pandemic. 7 months have passed since. The PLA has not pulled back. Instead, China has opened territorial battles on multiple fronts. Just yesterday, Japan and South Korea scrambled fighter jets for a joint patrol mission over the Western Pacific, after Chinese and Russian jets flew over the Sea of Japan and the East China Sea. China is getting more aggressive by the day. The military threat is real and growing. There is a need for a new threat assessment. Tonight, we bring you an exclusive conversation with Yasuhide Nakayama, the Deputy Defense Minister of Japan. He's also a member of Japanese Prime Minister Yoshihide Suga's party. He's part of a group of lawmakers that took a hard line against China earlier this year when a call was made to cancel a state visit by Xi Jinping to Japan. That's after Beijing began the clampdown in Hong Kong. A lot, as we said, has happened since. China's aggression has only grown. Japan, we know, is a key ally of India in countering China. How can the two coordinate better to ensure peace in the Indo-Pacific? What does Japan make of the border standoff in Ladakh? Can world bodies hold China accountable for the pandemic cover-up and for the military aggression? Earlier today, we put these questions to Mr. Nakayama. Minister Nakayama, welcome to WION.
Thank you very much, Park-san. I'm from Tokyo, and thank you very much for inviting me.
You spoke about the threat from China. Do you believe that the Wuhan virus is indeed a bioweapon, that it was created in a laboratory, or was it a natural outbreak?
There is lots of stories, and there is lots of explanation or the the professional doctor's view. But I personally think, and also as a Japanese government, I don't think it's a man-made or not, but we have to watch carefully, even it's a man-made or not. This year, there is a COVID-19. Sometimes people said it's a Wuhan virus, but this virus actually came from Wuhan, China, and the COVID-19 expands all over the world immediately, including Japan and India also. And we have to also prepare for those kind of new biochemical and also virus threat. And how should we keep those, you know, the social welfare and also public sanitary systems for protecting the people's lives and the health?
The World Health Organization will start an investigation into the origin of the Wuhan virus next month. What are your expectations from it? Do you believe it will be a fair probe, given the fact that this global agency has been accused of being influenced by Beijing on more occasions than one?
It's a very difficult issue, but I believe in God. And I hope that God will make a decision and God will watch whatever there is evidence or not. And people who are going to investigate or research about that issue, I hope the people who is going to do that hopefully be honest to the entire world. Because even the WHO, Dr. Tedros, he pointed at Taiwan, and Taiwan is the problem from his point of view. And one of the students who studied in United Kingdom, she is you know, the bright future medical doctor student. And she officially claimed and claimed to the Dr. Tedros about this issue on YouTube. But Dr. Tedros still didn't respond to this Taiwanese student, medical student, about her questions. And I think that Taiwan is the number one country who did how to say, protect the country from the Wuhan virus, I mean the COVID-19. And so even it is man-made or not, even the investigation is going forward or not, I think the Chinese government and also WHO have to explain what's going on to the people of the world. And we would like to know what is the real situation going on from the original point of the virus.
Minister Nakayama, how do you see China's military provocations on the border with India?
We, the Japan, would like to say both countries should try to, you know, to make a friction temperature to become lower, and hopefully one day shake hand each other, and hopefully to make effort to how to say, to make a peace between the two countries' border. But on the other hand, I know it's very tough and difficult, and we, the Japan, also have lots of fear from the Chinese military activities. So I personally, I can understand Indians' feelings towards those matters.
Right, like you said, China claims the Senkaku Islands that you say belong to Japan. Similarly, China also wrongly stakes claim on parts of Ladakh and Arunachal Pradesh that belong to India. It does not follow international law when it comes to the South China Sea. What can global bodies like the United Nations, for instance, do to hold China accountable then?
Yes, exactly. But unfortunately, P5, China is a P5. Yes, so if something, the problems for them, problems for China issue raise up in the United Nations, I think they can, you know, against it. So if the United Nations try to do what Ms. Parikshan said. It is very difficult to raise up the issue in the United Nations. But, you know, now you told about Indian's fear or concern. We, the Japan, has a mutual concern as your country. So why don't we make more friends or, you know, the country who has a mutual fear or threat or concern get together and appeal to the another countries, and then they can get understands more about those issues. So we need a challenge to the world for the future. We are a democratic country. India, also democratic country. The United States of America, democratic country. Those country and Australia also, we understand about how important the democratic system and the free and open Indo-Pacific concept is very important. So a country who can understand this concept, any country can join. And I know personally India's position, but I personally request India should more, commit to protect free and open Indo-Pacific. We want India. We want strong India, and we want India. India is, the ASEAN's gravity point. India is very important because you surrounded by your own fear or concern. So, but your country is most important freedom country and the nation. And we have a lot of sympathy. If Japan, India, Australia, United States together, you know, the good synergy will came up to our, future. So we love India, and we want Indians more commitment towards a Quad.
Japan has seen a leadership transition recently, and very soon the U.S. too will have a new president in office. What bearing, if any, according to you, will this have on bilateral relations between Tokyo and Washington? And what are your expectations from the Biden administration?
Well, I have one question to next president elect, Mr. Joe Biden. When the Assad in Syria, when he used biochemical weapon towards their nationals, at that time President Obama was in White House, and he set the red line for Assad regime. But actually, unfortunately, Assad used biochemical weapons towards the people of Syria. But White House didn't respond it, didn't react. And I was very sad because who the political leader use biochemical weapons towards their own people. This is crazy. And the United States, I personally think, should respond at that time, but actually didn't. Time has been changed even within 5 years. But if the China going to challenge towards the Taiwan issue, I think the next red line is going to become China and also Taiwan border. This border is going to become another red line which White House should think about. And my question to Mr. Joe Biden, President-elect, is what is his policy? What is your policy towards Taiwan issue? Compared to, I'm not comparing with Donald Trump president, but I would like to know how the next president-elect will going to make a policy towards Taiwan means what is his policy towards China. It's equal. So that is my, the focusing on, yes.
Minister Nakayama, it was good to speak to you. Thank you very much for joining us here on WION.
No, thank you very much.
Brexit was the endless saga of the last decade. The referendum was held almost 4.5 years back, and since then, Britain has had 2 general elections and 2 prime ministers. Progress has been slow, but the end is finally here. On Christmas Eve, after all the haggling, the UK and the EU have announced a trade deal. The clock is not ticking anymore. That's how EU Commission President Ursula von der Leyen described the moment. She said the deal was fair and balanced, and that the UK and the EU would continue to stand shoulder to shoulder when it mattered.
The United Kingdom is a third country, but it remains a trusted partner. We are long-standing allies. We share the same value and interests, whether it be the COP26 summit in Glasgow or the upcoming UK G7 and Italian G20 presidencies. The European Union and the United Kingdom will stand shoulder to shoulder to deliver on our common global goals. Competition in our single market will be fair and remain so. The EU rules and standards will be respected. We have effective tools to react if fair competition is distorted and impacts our trade.
As for Boris Johnson, he feels this is the best deal the UK could have hoped for.
Since that time, we've been getting on with our agenda, enacting the points-based immigration system that you voted for and that will come into force on January the 1st, doing free trade deals with 58 countries around the world, and preparing the new relationship with the EU. And there have been plenty of people who have told us that the challenges of the COVID pandemic have made this work impossible, and that we should extend the transition period and incur yet more delay. And I rejected that approach precisely because beating COVID is our number one national priority. And I wanted to end any extra uncertainty and to give this country the best possible chance of bouncing back strongly next year.
Many of you are probably wondering, didn't Brexit happen last year? Well, technically it did. On the 31st of December 2019, Britain officially left the European Union. But a lot of details were yet to be agreed upon, chief among them, trade. Britain and the EU had to sign a new trade deal, and they had 11 months to do so. And it came right down to the wire. Without a deal, there would have been a hard Brexit. No more free trade, no more free movement, plus new import tariffs, and that would have hurt consumers. In the end, the talks hinged on fish. You heard that right. The UK and the EU could not agree on fishing rights. Let me explain this. In the European Union, the seas are common good, so all countries can fish in each other's waters. Britain wanted to change this. It wanted to decide who gets to fish in British waters. The middle ground was to have quotas. The EU pushed for a greater share, a demand that Britain would have never accepted. The current deal calls for a phased fishing arrangement. Over the next 5.5 years, the EU is going to gradually reduce fishing. That will leave the UK with around 2/3 of the fishing stock. Now, as this deal gets implemented next year, disputes will be inevitable. So who is going to resolve them? Before Brexit, you see, the European Court of Justice had this responsibility. But EU courts are run by EU laws, laws that do not apply to Britain anymore. So both sides have agreed on a new system based on international law. The reaction to this deal has been mixed. Remember, the referendum back in 2016 was a close one. Almost 48% of Britons wanted to remain in the European Union, and the years have not changed how they feel about it.
Well, it's better than a no deal, but still all of the disadvantages of leaving the European Union. So it's making the best of a bad job.
I'm really pleased we're getting a deal. And I'm really, I think it, you know, it's light at the end of the tunnel. I think we've had a terrible year, and I think it's really good news, quite honestly. I was afraid of a no deal.
On Financial Street, the news was good. The pound sterling gained against the US dollar. The stock market also cheered the deal. Analysts are hoping that this bit of news will help the markets end the year on a high.
British pound is doing well. The British pound is up about 0.9% versus the US dollar, so it's on a pretty good run. And we're in a very reasonably short distance away. If the pound nudges another small bit higher, another kind of 10 basis points or 10 pips higher, you know, we'll be looking at a new, you know, two and a half year high versus the US dollar. So we are seeing a pretty generous move in the pound.
Like I said at the start, this has been an endless saga. So is it finally over, or are we in for more drama? In the United Kingdom, the Parliament must approve this new deal. The MPs will be recalled soon. But there's no drama expected, thankfully. Keir Starmer has asked his Labour Party to back the new deal. In the European Union, the deal does not technically need parliamentary approval unless any of the provisions directly mention a member state. But again, this is just a matter of formality. Boris Johnson, remember, came to power promising to get Brexit done. He's finally got something to show for his work, but the transition is not going to be smooth. The long line of truckers at Dover was a glimpse into what a post-Brexit UK could be like. And now to the story that we've been tracking very closely on Gravitas, the mysterious death of activist Karima Baloch. She was found dead in Canada. She reportedly faced threats from the Pakistani military, but the Toronto police says there is no foul play. Those who've tracked the plight of the Baloch people say it is murder, and it fits a pattern. Baloch activists living outside Pakistan have repeatedly come under attack. A few months back, there was a similar death in Sweden. Canada insists that this is a non-criminal case. In Balochistan, there are protests and a call for justice. Fingers are pointing at Pakistan, but there are no concrete answers. Before I get you the latest, let me quickly tell you what's happened so far. Karima Baloch was a 37-year-old activist. She went missing on the 20th of December. One day later, she was found dead. Reports say her body was found floating in a lake in Toronto. There is no official confirmation on that. Karima Baloch was credited for being the pioneer of women's rights in Balochistan. She was also a vocal critic of Pakistan. In 2016, she put out a video message for India's Prime Minister Narendra Modi. She'd been living in exile in Canada for about 5 years now. She had raised concerns about Canada allowing a number of Pakistani military officials to live in the country. Karima Baloch's family says that she had been receiving death threats, and now Karima Baloch is dead under mysterious circumstances. How many Karimas will you kill is the question being asked in Quetta, the capital of Balochistan. What you see on your screen are images of a protest march. There was a protest in Karachi too, in solidarity with Karima Baloch. The trending hashtag is State Killed Karima Baloch, but Canada says there was no foul play. It sees no foul play here. WION wrote to the Toronto police on the 22nd of December inquiring about Karima's death and the investigation into it. The police told us that the case is, quote unquote, currently being investigated as a non-criminal death and there are not believed to be any suspicious circumstances. Toronto police posted a statement a day later, and I'm quoting again, the Toronto police is aware of heightened community and media interest surrounding a missing person investigation. The circumstances have been investigated and officers have determined this to be a non-criminal death and no foul play is suspected. 3 days into the incident, the police has already concluded that the death is non-criminal. Very prompt, we say. Sadly, no one's buying it. Karima Baloch's husband, for one, Hamal Heather, has asked for a further inquiry. And here's what he said. My wife was an immensely courageous and spirited person. Her work as an internationally prominent activist speaks for itself. I believe it's our right to request the Canadian authorities to leave no stone unturned in looking into the circumstances of her death, as well as the threats she has been facing since moving to the country. We have cooperated with the police and will continue to do so. Unquote. So here are some questions. Why is the Toronto police treating this death as an open and shut case? Why is Canada's Prime Minister Justin Trudeau silent about this? Well, he's had a lot to say about a farmer's protest thousands of miles away. Trudeau was apparently seriously concerned about the rights of these protesters. Now, in his own backyard, a prominent human rights activist has been found dead. The whole world is talking about it, but Justin Trudeau remains quiet. His country's police says there is no foul play. What gives? What explains the silence? Vote bank politics again. Pakistanis are the fifth largest group of immigrants in Canada. Justin Trudeau does not want to lose their support, perhaps, by pointing fingers at their home country. Canada does not want to deep dive into a case whose trails may lead to Pakistan and Rawalpindi. Did you know that Canada had initially denied asylum to Karima Baloch? On what grounds? They said her group's involvement in quote-unquote subversion against the Pakistani government was the reason. So you know where Justin Trudeau's loyalties lie. It is barely surprising that the Toronto police is not suspecting any foul play in Karima Baloch's death. It is not surprising that Mr. Trudeau, the self-appointed torchbearer of the right to protest, has nothing to say about the protests in his own country and in Pakistan. It is time the Canadian Prime Minister got off his high horse, put an end to minority appeasement, and get a grip on the extremists operating in his own country. He can start by ordering an honest probe into Karima Baloch's death. The Central African Republic, or the CAR, is a country we rarely hear about. You will not see it in the headlines very often, but today, it is the setting for a game of geopolitics, geopolitical chess. In a couple of days, this country will vote for its next president. But violence is threatening to derail the vote. And Russia and the United States are volunteering to help. Both nations have their eye on the Central African Republic's vast mineral reserves. Our next report tells you more.
This is the Central African Republic, located slap bang in the middle of Africa. It is rich in most resources known to man, yet languishes in poverty. In 3 days, the CAR will go to polls. The country is on edge, and understandably so. Democracy has been sporadic here. A coup d'etat is always around the corner. The CAR was a French colony. It became independent in 1960. The last six decades have seen elections and military coups, followed by a seemingly endless civil war. There have been peace deals, but no peace. In 2015, the UN deployed around 13,000 peacekeepers, but stability remains elusive. It is in this backdrop that CAR is heading to polls. The threat of military coups, the bloodshed of a civil war, and extreme economic hardships. Now the country must contend with a new problem, a pseudo-Cold War. Russia and the United States both want to assert their influence here. For the moment, Moscow holds the edge. Incumbent President Tuadera is a close ally of Putin. Since 2018, Russia has propped up the government multiple times. In return, Russian companies get to exploit CAR's vast resources. Ahead of the elections, Tuadera once again reached out to Moscow. He is afraid that rebel groups are planning to take the capital. There are reports that Bambari, a trading hub, has already fallen. Russia's response was swift. It sent 300 military instructors to train the CAR troops. They were joined by Rwandan forces who were assisting the peacekeepers. The US State Department was not impressed. Our position has always been that countries that provide assistance, military or otherwise, should do so in a transparent and coordinated way, and that this assistance should support the desire of the people of CAR for good governance and stability. Not to be left behind, the Western Alliance dispatched help of its own. On Wednesday, French warplanes flew over the country. The Elysee Palace condemned attempts to disrupt the general elections. It's a zero-sum game for the Central African Republic. Going ahead with the polls means risking the lives of voters, but delaying it could further destabilize the country. President Touadera is banking on foreign help, but he's playing a dangerous game. It doesn't take long for an ally to become a satellite state. Bureau Report, WION. World is One.
Meanwhile, in the United States, Donald Trump is on a pardon spree. Two Republican politicians, four convicts connected to the Russia probe, four former security officials accused of war crimes, and the disgraced father of his son-in-law, Jared Kushner. These are just a few individuals who have been pardoned by President Donald Trump. A total of 41 pardoned by the U.S. president in a matter of 2 days. 41 people. What is a presidential pardon, you may ask? Who are the people Donald Trump has pardoned, and what are the charges against them? In this report, we shall discuss. First of all, a presidential pardon is an act that completely sets aside the punishment for a federal crime. In simpler words, it means that you're forgiven for crimes that you have or you may have committed. If you're in jail, you'll walk out. If you're out, the case against you cannot be revived. The only thing that the pardon does not give you is a clean slate. It does not wipe out the record of your conviction. So who has Donald Trump pardoned? Like I said, it's a long list. On Tuesday, Trump issued pardons to 15 people, 15. On Wednesday, he pardoned 26 more, 41 people in 48 hours. And this is in addition to several others he has pardoned since Election Day. More than 60 so far. I'll tell you the names that stand out. Duncan Hunter, a former Republican congressman who in 2019 pleaded guilty for misusing campaign funds. Chris Collins, another former Republican representative, he pleaded guilty last year for conspiring to commit a securities fraud, besides making false statements to the FBI. Then we have Paul Manafort, Trump's former campaign chairman, Roger Stone, one of Trump's oldest friends. Manafort was convicted for conspiring to obstruct the investigation of his crimes. And Roger Stone was convicted of witness tampering to protect Trump in the Russia probe, the Mueller probe. Then we have national security officials, Nicholas Slatin, Paul Slow, Evan Liberty, and Dustin Hurd. Four security contractors who were convicted for their role in the 2007 massacre of 14 unarmed Iraqi civilians in Baghdad. They have been pardoned by the commander-in-chief. George Papadopoulos, a former Trump campaign aide who pleaded guilty to Russian meddling in the 2016 presidential election, he too has been pardoned. Alex van der Zwan, the Dutch son-in-law of Russian billionaire German Khan, has been pardoned. This man was charged for lying during the Mueller investigation about being in contact with a Trump campaign official. And then we come to the most controversial pardon of them all. Charles Kushner, a wealthy real estate executive and the father of Trump's son-in-law, Jared Kushner. Charles Kushner pleaded guilty to tax evasion and to lying to the U.S. Election Commission. He also pleaded guilty to witness tampering, and you must listen to this very carefully. Charles Kushner's brother-in-law was cooperating with investigators in tax evasion charges against Kushner. So Kushner Sr. decided to do something. He hired a sex worker to lure his own brother-in-law. Then he videotaped the encounter and sent that tape to his sister as blackmail. Who does that? The attorney looking after this case had called it, and I'm quoting, one of the most loathsome and disgusting crimes he had ever prosecuted. But all of Charles Kushner's crimes were set to be whitewashed. He has been pardoned by his relative, the President of the United States of America. Now, here's the thing. American presidents pardon convicts. This is part of a tradition. Most presidents before Donald Trump have used the pardon to address systemic injustice, like racist drug sentences or politically motivated punishments. But Donald Trump is using his powers to pardon allies, loyalists, and family members. He is testing the limits of the many constraints of his powers. And he's undermining the very motive of a presidential pardon. So pardon me for saying this. We shall not be surprised if Donald Trump takes things one step further and becomes the first American president to pardon himself.
Corn, I hereby grant you a full pardon.
And now to the biggest story from across the border. The time for performance has arrived in Pakistan. Listen to this.
और जितना भी अब बाकी टाइम रह गया हमें अब अपनी जो गवर्नेंस की परफॉर्मेंस है उसको बहुत आगे लेके जाना है क्योंकि अब हमारे पास तो एक्सक्यूज नहीं है कि हम सीख रहे हैं या हम नए हैं या तजर्बा नहीं था क्योंकि हमारी तो गवर्नमेंट पहली दफ़ा ज़्यादातर लोग पहली दफ़ा पावर में आए तो ये अब परफॉर्मेंस का टाइम आ गया और परफॉर्मेंस के लिए अपने ऊपर प्रेशर डालें अब
After 2 years, 4 months and 25 days in power, Imran Khan Niazi has finally realized that it is time to perform. He wants his ministers to pressure themselves to perform. He wants to assess the performance of the various ministries that they handle. We decided to save him the effort. I'll start with the ministry Imran Khan must pay close attention to, the Petroleum Ministry of Pakistan. Saudi Arabia has shut the oil taps. Islamabad has failed to be worth the oil it was getting from Riyadh. So this is how the Petroleum Ministry of Pakistan has been performing. It has been smuggling oil from Iran. An inquiry commission set up by Pakistan's judiciary has discovered that in 2020, this year, the Petroleum Ministry of Pakistan smuggled Iranian oil worth 250 billion Pakistani rupees. Smuggled. How did they manage this? With the help of Pakistan's Frontier Corps paramilitary force, custom authorities and the oil mafia. The inquiry commission says all of them colluded in the smuggling of oil over the Pakistan-Iran border near Taftan in the province of Balochistan. They smuggled oil and it was brought in 50,000-litre tankers. Baiko Refinery, a private firm in Balochistan, was deeply involved in the smuggling. Quite a performance, we say. Let's also take a look at how the Transport Ministry of Pakistan has been performing. An anti-graft watchdog has unearthed a mega scandal in Lahore. The Transport Ministry of Pakistan and its officials had been issuing registrations for smuggled and stolen vehicles on the basis of fake auction vouchers. Now, this watchdog says officials from the excise and taxation departments were involved in this scam. It says the registration of as many as 15,000 vehicles was dubious. 15,000 vehicles. The scam caused a direct loss of 300 billion Pakistani rupees to the exchequer. There are so many scams happening in Pakistan that even China is now worried. Beijing has started seeking guarantees for the loans it's been giving out to Islamabad. The Pakistani media has been reporting this. They've been talking about it. They say China has sought additional guarantees before sanctioning a $6 billion loan for a rail project. Let me explain how this works. Pakistan's financial situation, as all of us know, has been weakening. The country has been availing debt relief from G20 nations. Now, China wants Pakistan to ensure that it will pay its Chinese debts first. In fact, they want the Pakistan government to put a guarantee mechanism in place for any loans henceforth. What a sad turn of events. Pakistan has long run out of the time to perform. The administration is riddled with corruption. The ministers are looting the country's wealth. Pakistani citizens are struggling to earn money and make ends meet. A journalist recently asked Prime Minister Imran Khan if the general public should commit suicide instead. This is what he told her.
Sir, you say that my 2 lakh tanha hai. Mera usme guzara nahi hota. Sir, yahan pe 17-18,000 mein log kaise guzara karenge? Iska hal kya hai?
Lekin Paris, main aapko ye samjha raha hoon. Iska hal ye hai ki apne mulk ki daulat badhaye, wealth create kare.
Aur jab tak nahi hoti, log khudkushiyan kare.
Kya kare aap? Mujhe ye bataye na.
Aap marne denge, aap hukmaran hain.
Aur se par se sun le. Ab kya karenge, mujhe bataye.
Well, that's not the end of our Pakistan story. Remember Daniel Pearl, the American journalist who was kidnapped and beheaded by Pakistani terrorists. In case you don't, let me tell you his story in brief. Daniel Pearl was the South Asia bureau chief of the Wall Street Journal based in Mumbai. In January 2002, he traveled to Pakistan for an investigation into the Al-Qaeda's links with a British citizen. He was kidnapped by extremists who accused him of being a spy. They demanded the release of certain Pakistani prisoners at Guantanamo Bay. That did not happen. So these terrorists beheaded Daniel Pearl. They cut his body into pieces and buried him in a village near Karachi. It took 3 months for Pakistani authorities to recover his severed head and mutilated body. This happened 18 years back. So why are we talking about this now? Because the man charged with Daniel Pearl's murder is set to walk free. I'm talking about Ahmed Omar Saeed Sheikh. Earlier this year, he was acquitted of all charges. Now, the Sindh High Court has ordered the immediate release of this man, and he is not alone. The charges against three other accused in the case have also been declared null and void. The judge who passed this order observed, and I'm quoting, "These men have been rotting in jail for 18 years without committing any crime." He said, "There are no justified reasons for their detention, and that of Ahmed Omar Saeed Sheikh in particular." Now, let me remind you something. The man, they say, has been rotting in jail, served prison time in India for the 1994 kidnappings of Western tourists, a crime that he confessed to. In 1999, he was released from captivity in exchange for passengers on board the hijacked Indian Airlines flight. He was provided safe passage into Afghanistan by Talibani terrorists. And then he went on to kidnap and murder Daniel Pearl in 2002. The Pakistani judiciary itself sentenced this man to death. His complicity in the murder of this murder is a matter of record. But 18 years on, the same judiciary says that this man is innocent. We'd heard of U-turns, but this is a quantum jump into denial. A complete travesty of justice. The so-called luminaries of Pakistan should hang their head in shame, if they have any left, that is. Let's move to a story from Kuwait. The country is being trolled online over its Parliamentary Committee on Women. Do you know why? Because the Committee on Women has men. Three men, no women. Here's why.
Imagine building a stadium to encourage sports and fitness and filling it with junk and video games. Imagine starting an animal welfare organization and enrolling hunters, butchers, and breeders into it. Imagine being a part of a panel on bungee jumping, but having never jumped or even seen the sport once. Exactly. This is what we are hinting at. The three men who have been elected to Kuwait's Parliamentary Committee for Women. As the name goes, this committee is meant for women. But its members are all men. Kuwait's official electronic paper put out this proud tweet on December the 22nd. It read, "Members of Parliamentary Women's Committee." Below it, photos of three men, followed by their names. Only a further reminder of their gender. Twitterati couldn't get enough. "Good luck, ladies," tweeted one user. Another was out of words, so she posted this meme. "Where are the women in this?" asked one. We had the same question, so we did some research. Turns out there are no women in Kuwait's parliament. 50 seats, all backed by men. In 2020, 29 female candidates ran for the general elections. None won. Safe to say that Kuwait is not your textbook example for women empowerment. It has definitely come a long way, but it has miles to go. So how does Kuwait plan to empower its women? How does it plan to improve their lives? Nominating men to a women's committee won't help unless Kuwait expects men to understand women issues better. That's a road we don't want to go down. So if you don't have women for a women's committee, then you need to find a solution. Nominate, legislate, debate. You will surely find a way to bring women to the negotiating table. Turning a women's committee into a women not allowed club is not an option. Bureau Report, WION, World is One.
On that note, it's a wrap. We're leaving you as always with Gravitas Images. Thanks for watching.